Great is the energy of infinite intelligence. Great is all that was created by that energy. Good morning.
Good morning.
Everybody's good, right? I'm Cheryl. I'm your seminary student, and as always, it's a pleasure to be here today with you and serve you. Please rise for the opening hymn for the beauty of the earth and remain standing for the prayer of invocation and the Lord's Prayer. Please keep standing. We're going to have the prayer of invocation and the Lord's Prayer, so please join me in an attitude of prayer. Father, Mother, God, great creator of all things, we come here this morning in gratitude for all the blessings that we receive daily. When we try to understand the vastness of the universe, we are overcome by the majesty of creation. Enable our awareness to become spacious this morning as we strive for a true understanding of divine wisdom as reflected in our principles as metaphysics. We pray for all to be aware of the constant presence of the energy of infinite intelligence in our lives and in their lives, so they may feel the love of this energy, which loves all. We ask the sick be healed, the unloved be loved, and the lonely be comforted. We as a congregation of spiritual unity pray for all souls everywhere and visualize that we all will experience universal love and peace. All of this we pray in the name of our way-shower, who taught us to pray together, praying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from error. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now you may be seated. Our meditation song, oh no, we have got something else special this morning. We're going to do it's almost a responsive reading. We all are going to read, there's a handout inside of your bulletin. We all are going to read the light print, which is the principle, and then I am going to give you some additional knowledge, which is the bold print. You won't read that, you will listen to it and absorb it as you think about what this principle means. So everybody, we believe in God as infinite intelligence. This infinite intelligence is the source of all creation, unconditional love, and power. This infinite intelligence is what some people call God. We believe that the phenomena of nature, both physical and spiritual, are the expressions of infinite intelligence. Everyone and everything are part of God's consciousness. Everyone and everything are connected to the energy of our Creator. Everyone and everything are infinite, powerful, perfect, whole, and complete. Just as our Creator is powerful, perfect, whole, and complete. We affirm that a correct understanding of such expression and living in accordance therewith constitute a true religion. Religion realigns our thoughts with these truths. We use truth to create our perfect world, our heaven here on earth. We believe in personal responsibility and that we create our own happiness or unhappiness as we live in harmony or discord with natural, physical, and spiritual laws. We create the world based on our consciousness. As our consciousness shifts to be in accordance with the truths listed above, we realign with God and the bliss of union. We affirm that the existence and personal identity of the individual continues after leaving the physical world. We are manifestations of imperishable patterns of divine energy. So our souls, with all the knowledge and all the experience that they hold, continue. Affirm that communication with spirit is a natural experience and is demonstrated through mediumship. Our souls are the medium between the physical and spiritual worlds. As we attune to our spiritual senses, we open our hearts and hear all the amazing channels of communication that the energy of infinite intelligence has created for us. We affirm that spiritual gifts, including prophecy and healing, contained in the Bible and other sacred texts, are divine attributes found in all people. God immunes all souls with spiritual gifts. Sacred texts chronicle stories of some who have developed their gifts to a higher magnitude in service to the divine. We believe that the highest morality is contained in the golden rule. Behave towards others as you would have them behave towards you. Everyone and everything are manifestations of God's unconditional love. So we treat ourselves, everyone, and everything with dignity, respect, reverence, and love. Affirm that the doorway to reformation is always open to any soul here or hereafter. Our perception can shift at any time. We can transform any situation by invoking the amazing grace of infinite intelligence. That was different, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Our meditation music this morning is The Presence of the Lord with Eric Clapton and Steve Winwood. Please listen to the words as you prepare yourself for meditation and think about how comfortable you are in the presence of infinite intelligence, which is with us always.
Thank you.
Take a deep breath in and slowly allow it to escape. Sink into your chair and allow gravity to take over the job of holding you. Put all your everyday stresses and anxieties into a red balloon and release them into the atmosphere. Watch as they drift away, feeling the relief of freedom as they disappear from sight. Now we are ready to go to that peaceful, still place within. We are now safe, comfortable, and free to go anywhere we wish. As we review the words of the meditation song, we think, do I really know how to live comfortably in the presence of infinite intelligence? Do we realize that the energy of infinite intelligence is our life partner forever? Do we understand how sacred that makes us, the energy that created us and everything else in the universe? How vast and beautiful is the creation of infinite intelligence? Now take a deep breath and see in your mind's eye the beautiful white light of divine love pouring over us, entering our crown chakra and filling our feet, legs, torso, hands, arms, neck, and head, and then surrounding us, forming a mist that resembles an eggshell. We feel so safe and peaceful, surrounded by the light of divine love. Now we're going to call in our master spirit guide. Don't worry if you don't know who it is or what they look like. They know you. They know who you are and will answer when you call. Mentally ask them to come in now. Don't be surprised if that spirit guide appears as a color, a mist, a feeling, or if they send messages to your head that only you can hear. Greet them with great love, for your master guide has volunteered to help you reach the highest spirituality that is possible for you at this time. Your master guide moves his hand and a door spins open, displaying a night sky with stars shining like diamonds against black velvet. Your master guide smiles, and you are enveloped in a positive, loving energy. You offer your hand to the master because you want them to lead the way. And slowly you begin to rise and rise up in the night sky, weightlessly into the canopy of stars. You move at a comfortable pace, and you know you are safe with your master's hand tight over yours. You know intuitively you're going to places you have never even thought possible. You see a large spiral whirlpool. Your master tells you that is the Andromeda galaxy. It is so big, with blue, white, and purple lights appearing in the spiraling energy encircling the entire galaxy. You can see the aura nebula of browns and oranges and other colors, much like Earth's colors. And past that, you see colors that you have never dreamed of that are so beautiful and complex. As you pass close to a pillar on a small meteorite, your master teacher floats you inside of a crystal temple that is sitting on the meteorite. Here the floor is covered in some soft, smooth material with big fluffy cushions all around. You are gently lowered on one of the cushions. Mentally, your master teacher tells you that there are others here who want to meet you. You lay on the pillows and look up. And as you look up at the top of the temple, it opens, and numerous little round light forms float down towards you. As you look closer, you see small faces, arms, and legs of light forming these circles. They encircle you and smile. Some touch you lovingly. Some talk to you. They recognize you as one of them, a light worker, and they are happy to meet you. You feel precious, loved, and special as they continue to shower their love upon you. Then they all mold together and disappear out the opening. Your master teacher appears and takes your hand again. Am I one of them? You ask yourself silently. And silently, your master teacher replies, of course you are. You are a light worker in a body placed on earth. They are light workers placed in the vastness of space to help beings here. You are to help beings on earth by showing them love and compassion and by displaying the gifts you were endowed with by infinite intelligence. You smile, remembering how good the tiny light worker energy felt. How can I be that loving? You ask yourself repeatedly. And your master teacher replies, learn to use your gifts. Learn to follow natural law and spiritual law, and you will be fulfilling your purpose on earth, and you are equipped to do both. Do you believe that an energy that could create all the majesty that you have seen have not gifted you also? Suddenly you're back at the door again, looking out at the night. Your master teacher is gone. You are back on earth, and as you shut the door, you're back in All Souls Metaphysical Chapel. You smile to yourself, remembering the warm love of the light workers and how safe you felt with your master spirit guide. You remember being told that you were gifted. You find yourself filled with a thirst to know more about your gifts so that you can become an active light worker too. Now open your eyes slowly as we turn up the lights in the chapel. Now you can satisfy that thirst by listening to the lecture today, which is entitled, Who and What We Are. Our scripture today is 1 Corinthians 12, 4-11. There are diversities of gift, but there is only one Spirit. There are diversities of ministry, but there is only one Lord. There are diversities of power, but there is only one God who works through all things in man. The manifestations of Spirit is given to every man as to help him. For to one is given the Spirit of the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another workings of miracles, and to another prophecy, to another the means to distinguish the true Spirit, to another different languages, to another interpretation of languages. All these gifts are brought by the same Spirit, divided to everyone individually as he will. The gifts of Spirit are the various phases of mediumship demonstrated throughout the Bible, and they are present in all of us. Who and what are we? We are people who study divine metaphysics. That is what our beliefs are. We believe by practicing divine metaphysics, we can discover and demonstrate these gifts of spirit. Divine metaphysics is a science, a philosophy, and a religion which accepts the existence of infinite intelligence. Metaphysics is a science. It investigates, analyzes, and classifies facts and manifestations demonstrated from the spiritual side of life. It's a philosophy because it studies laws of nature, both seen and unseen, of life, and bases its conclusions on present observed facts. It is a religion because we strive to understand and comply with the physical, mental, and spiritual laws of nature, which are the laws of God. It practices and teaches the spiritual truths recorded in the Holy Bible and other sacred scriptures, and as revealed in the life and teachings of Jesus the Christ and other holy people of God. The most supreme of the spiritual truth is the fact life is continuous. The change called death is merely a rebirth into a world of higher vibration. This truth is proven by communication by means of mental and physical mediumship with loved ones and teachers who live in the spirit world. We take the Bible seriously, but not precisely, not word for word. We do not accept the Bible as the Word of God, incapable of being wrong. It has been translated many, many times, and when it was written, it was part of the culture and social experience of that time. We read the Bible as a book of the light of soul, a metaphysical history of transcending consciousness. That is a history which tells the story of human consciousness constantly rising above culture, environments, demanding situations, and trying events, including self-imposed limitations. The Bible leads us from the Old Testament and the laws of Jehovah, an eye for an eye, into God as spirit worship of grace and truth in the New Testament with Jesus, who taught Christ consciousness. So the Bible is a book of guidance, instruction, and teaching intended to enlighten us. It's a record also of Hebrew law, drama, sacred history, philosophy, psychology, and religion. As metaphysicians, we accept truth in all sacred texts, but we embrace the life and teachings of Jesus the Christ as our way shower and primary teacher. Now, as metaphysicians, we are defined by our principles. Where'd they come from? How did we get our principles? The first three came from Harrison Barnett, who was born in Canaan, Maine in 1863 and graduated from Meadville, Pennsylvania Theological School. He became interested in spiritualism and in 1880 was elected president of the National Spiritualist Association of the United States and Canada. Now, in the early days of spiritualism, fortune telling was considered witchcraft. And we're not talking that long ago. And it was punishable by imprisonment. Many mediums were arrested and put on trial for witchcraft and imprisoned. Mr. Harrison was called to such a trial as a witness, and he insisted the woman was innocent of witchcraft. She was working within the parameters of her religion. The judge told him that if he could prove this religion was a true religion with a creed, he might let the woman go free. Mr. Harrison asked for recess and wrote the first three spiritualist principles, and they still stand today. We believe in infinite intelligence. We believe the phenomena of nature, both physical and spiritual, are the expression of this infinite intelligence, and we affirm that a correct understanding of such expression and living in accordance therewith constitute true religion. The woman was set free. The organization, the National Spiritual Association came into existence, and the beginning of religious groups who believed in mediumship and other demonstrations of gifts could now practice their beliefs with the protection of the law, since they belonged to an organized religion. To this day, membership in the United Metaphysical Church and other related churches is protection against arrest and imprisonment. Good for him. Other principles were added over time by various organizations, and today we have nine that define us. They explain what we believe, why we believe, and who we are. Why we are here and reassure us that everything is in divine order, despite the chaos that we find in the world and in our lives. Our first principle, we believe in God as infinite intelligence. Now, there's many words for that energy, God, Lord, Spirit, Tao, all types of things. In fact, there's no word that describes the magnificence of this energy. But we as humans strive to find something that we can label it with so that we can talk about it. So we often use God, Lord, Infinite Intelligence, Creator, Great Spirit interchangeably. Because honestly, there's not one word that really describes it. Just know that we are not talking about a personalized type of being. We are talking about energy. It's energy, not a personal thing. There's no arms, there's no legs, there's no head, nothing like that. It is a non-material level or a layer of dimension of reality that is in everything in the universe, not just in us. Everything, the chair, the light, the rug, planets, stars, dirt, everything. That energy created everything in its complexity or simplicity. There can be nothing that is not created by that energy. We cannot be anything or anyone that does not contain this energy. We are not separate from this energy. We are a part. Therefore, we always live in the presence of our Lord, in the presence of this energy. Our second principle states we believe in the phenomena of nature, both physical and spiritual, and we believe they're expression of infinite intelligence. Everything we experience has that energy. It includes animal, vegetable, and mineral kingdoms. There cannot be anything that exists outside of that energy. Don't be confused about some of the things that go on in this world. We say, why do these horrible things happen? Those things are not happened by God. They are happened by misuse of natural law or spiritual law. You know, a law automatically follows. If you hold a glass and let it slip, it will go to the floor and perhaps break. That is the law of gravity. It is there, it just happens. All of natural laws just happen. They follow whatever we do. So when we see all this chaos, it is not caused by God. It is caused by people, mostly in ignorance. Remember, we are always a part of that infinite intelligence. We are part of divinity. The third principle is we affirm that a correct understanding of such expression and living in accordance therewith constitute a true religion. If we are to obtain a correct understanding of this expression, we have to strive, work at understanding natural laws as well as spiritual laws. It is not enough to have a knowledge of the law. Anybody can read a book and say, I know about the law. We have to live our lives according to these laws if we want harmony and peace. If we can practice these laws, we can begin to manifest our own heaven here on earth. How many people feel like they're living in heaven on earth? Not too many. Why is that? Not necessarily because we're not manifesting, but other people are not. If we want to change this, what do we have to do? We have to concentrate on manifesting peace, harmony, love. Because at a certain point, if enough people think that way, there'll be a tipping point and others will follow. That is part of our job. That's part of the reason we're here, to convince other people this is the way to help people find peace. We believe in personal responsibility, that we create our own happiness or unhappiness and live in harmony or discord with natural and spiritual laws. We do not accept the principle of, vicarious atonement that the Christians believe in. When I first heard that, I didn't know what it was. I had to look it up. What it simply means is that Christians believe Jesus Christ died on the cross, and when he died, he was a sacrifice for all the sins that mankind had ever committed and would commit. Therefore, if you wanted to be forgiven of all the wrong things you did, all you had to do was ask for forgiveness. Well, we don't believe that one person can suffer on our behalf for all our wrongdoings. What would we learn from that? Nothing. Nothing. If you can be forgiven for anything, what is to stop you from doing anything? If all you have to do is ask. We believe that we create this world that we live in with our own thoughts. If we are in alignment with all the laws, and we are realigned with the energy of infinite intelligence, and we can experience bliss, the bliss of that union with us and the energy that created us. But if we pretend we don't know the laws, or we're ignorant, we're just going to create negative energy and suffer the results. That's what it is. When I was working at the domestic violence shelter, I had a woman who called up and said, "Please come and get me now. I got mad at my husband. I put all of his clothes in the bathtub and burned them. And when he comes home and he finds out, he's going to kill me." Of course, we went and got her. But the first question in my mind was, what were you thinking he would do? You know, why would you burn somebody's clothes and not think they would be a little upset about that? And yet, there they were on the phone asking us to rescue them. It doesn't work that way. When you do things, ultimately, you have to pay for them somehow. I hope nobody's foolish enough to do something like that. I know nobody's foolish enough to do something like that here, but we often let our emotions carry us away, say things or do things that we know we shouldn't be doing. But we will pay for them later and correct them later. The fifth principle is we affirm the existence and personal identity of the individual after leaving the physical world. We are manifestations of imperishable patterns of divine energy. We were made and created by the energy of infinite intelligence to contain part of that energy. Because we are energy, we never perish. And science has proven you cannot destroy energy. It may change its form, but it never goes away. These chairs that are here may change, but they will form something else. The walls may change, but they'll form something else because they contain energy. Energy never disappears. So, of course, we don't stop existing. We live continually. And the proof of that is by use of our gifts of mediumship. We've seen examples in the Bible of Jesus appearing at least 7 times after his death. Moses and Elijah appearing on the Mount of Transfiguration and being recognized long after their death. People confirmed this. And our mediumship confirms this principle. The sixth is that we affirm communication with a spirit is a natural experience and demonstrated through mediumship. Our souls are the medium between the physical and spiritual world. The very fact that we receive messages from that spiritual world confirms to us that we live forever. We don't have the time to go in. We'd be here forever. If I went into all the examples in the Bible of people receiving messages. Consider all the communications that David, Moses, and Abraham had with the divine. Remember the angel talking to Mary, telling her to name the child Jesus, or giving messages to Joseph warning him to take his family into Egypt to protect this child. There's so many more examples. Our teachers, our guides, masters, and angels, they're all messengers from divine mind, working with us individually and collectively to shift the consciousness of the human family to a higher vibration. And that is our goal. Because as we shift, we bring other people with us. And we will all rise. The seventh is that we affirm spiritual gifts, including prophecy and healing, in the Bible and other sacred texts. Are attributes found in all people. It's true. Those are things that are installed in us, part of us, before we come into being. We don't have to ask for them. We are permeated with qualities that we share with the energy that created us, including gifts of healing and mediumship in all forms. We are sensitive to the vibration from the realm of spirit. Some of us have to work a little harder to develop our sensitivity to receive those vibrations. Most of the time, we have to get out of our own way because we have other ideas that were embedded in us that we shouldn't be doing this or we can't do it or whatever. But this is the reason why we conduct mediumship development classes, to develop that sensitivity to higher levels. We are able to impart curative forces to pathological conditions. Shorthand, we can heal, generally healing energy. We have healing circles. We have Reiki shares that allow us to practice this channeling. Jesus was an example of a person who developed his gifts to a higher level to be of service to the energy of infinite intelligence. Our Creator has taken care of us by giving us these gifts. We honor our Creator by working to develop these gifts. The eighth principle states that we believe in the highest morality is contained in the Golden Rule. Every religion has a Golden Rule. Every religion that is practiced today. Different wording, but Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, everybody. We should treat everybody and everything with dignity, respect, reverence, and love, because we're all a manifestation of infinite intelligence, unconditional love. That is the highest rule. Kindness is more important than anything else. Of course, there's a lot of natural laws that are in effect. Probably the easiest one to explain in a small amount of time is cause and effect, which is just whatever energy we send out to people comes back to us. If we are hateful, we're mad at somebody, we want to get even, we want to hope that somebody has to experience the thing that we experience because we want them to feel pain, it comes back to you even stronger. This is one reason, a very selfish reason, but it's a good reason to love everyone and never wish anybody has any hardships. In effect, you're protecting yourself, but you're also doing something better. You're listening to the divine mind, which tells you you must love everybody and everything. The last principle is we affirm the doorway to reformation is never closed to any human soul here or after. If you have been in a Christian church, you have learned of hell, eternal damnation, all that good stuff. Doesn't exist. We can begin our spiritual progression anytime. Now is better than later, but we can do it anytime. We don't accept the idea that we get punished for our mistakes. We don't make mistakes, we make errors, okay? errors. I think I said mistakes. We don't sin. We make errors. We don't believe people sin. Because we live continually, we are given many opportunities to correct our errors. We can and must correct whatever we've done that has produced negative or inappropriate energies to work against ourselves or a fellow man or woman. The correction may be made here on earth, or it can be made after we pass to higher life. But it means we are never eternally punished for anything. This is more proof of the unending love we receive from the energy of infinite intelligence. We are supposed to live in the law of God, which is unconditional love, no matter what people do. But by correcting our errors, we learn, and as we learn, our perceptions shift. When we utterly understand, thoroughly understand what we did that was wrong, we feel terrible about it, we've made amends as best as we can, we understand what we did, we understand the harm that was caused, and internally we know that we will never do that again. Then we are free from karma that we have collected by making this error. The grace that we are given is that once we have learned the lesson completely, and I do mean completely, there are times when you think you've learned it completely and the same thing comes back up again. Well, there's a nuance someplace that you didn't pick up, so you have to experience it again. But if you really, really, really get it, we have a thing that infinite intelligence gives us called grace, which means it releases us from the karma of the many, 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 many times we committed this error. Simply because once we know it, there's no need to continue suffering the consequences. The key here is that you really have to never do it again and know what you did. The loving energy of infinite intelligence wants to care for us. It loves us. But we have to be in the state where that is possible, to receive that care and that love. Anyone seeking a spiritual pathway, a better way of life, or a desire for inner peace is invited to join us. We are a non-judgmental place of love where all people can feel safe while they're exploring their spirituality. We support the spiritual growth and development of everyone. We respect all religions and spiritual traditions. We might not believe in everything that they do, but we respect it. And we provide ministry and education for all members and friends and the community at large through our example and our services that are based on the principal teachings of divine metaphysics. We are an association that's based on metaphysical philosophy, utilizing the various inspired truths from many religions and doctrines, and we wish to teach and practice the science, philosophy, and religion as a serene way of life, so we can all walk with God and allow these principles and the love of infinite intelligence to guide us. Our mission statement is our purpose is to teach and practice the science, philosophy, and religion of divine metaphysics to promote the love and oneness of God within us. Our vision statement is becoming a worldwide beacon of love through our philosophy, education, and religion of divine metaphysics. What we have to offer is a continuality of life where we endeavor to learn, understand, and practice the highest level of spirituality that we can reach for. The highest level that will lead to the well-being of ourselves and the world as a whole. We offer acceptance and love and opportunity to learn how to live your life in peace and harmony so that you shine so brightly to all those who see you. They are inspired to learn the truth for themselves, that they may discover the gifts of spirit that are given to us in all the various phases of mediumship and learn how to practice them for the highest good of all. And so it is.